What's up? Hey, today we're going to talk about low pro operations or low profile or low visibility operations. Some of the things to consider, some of the stuff you may or may not want to wear, and how to wear that stuff. Okay, so what is low pro operations? Low pro or low profile or low visibility operations is basically all the same thing. it's just having a low profile. You don't want people to know who you are or what you're doing. You can see this in tons of movies. I'll go back to Zero Dark 30 when they're trying to get intel on certain people that are cruising around in that little van. They're taking pictures.
30, 40. 50. We're within 10 meters of it. Back to 40. He's here somewhere.
Look at the cars. Look at the cars. He's in the vehicle. The guy with the phone in a white car. You see him? Is that him?
Could be.
You got him?
Got him.
Okay.
This TV show that's on right now, I think it's like Navy SEALs or SEAL teams or something like that. They do low pro shit all the time. What else? In all CIA spy, cool guy, army movies, they'll do some sort of low profile stuff, right? I was never in the CIA. I was never a spook or whatever. So I didn't do super cool guy low pro operations. We did stuff that would like, we would go and check out venues, or we would drive people around that they didn't want big vehicles and all the vests and stuff out, things like that. So my low pro was a little bit different. As a cop, I did low pro operations for vehicle thefts, things like that, where we cruised around in an unmarked vehicle in civilian clothes and caught people stealing cars. let's see. Everybody's seen it. Everybody knows what it is. But there are a lot of things you need to consider when you're doing it. One, you need to consider where you're at. Are you in the Middle East? Are you in America? Are you in the, you know, metropolitan Los Angeles area? Are you in the sticks of Iowa or Arkansas? There's a lot of stuff that goes into this. So when you're looking at low pro operations, you can't just look at, well, I'm not wearing a big chest plate, so they won't know who I am. Yeah, but you're driving a brand new whatever car in an area that has zero brand new cars. Or you're a 6'2", 265, 270 pound white guy full of tattoos in a neighborhood where there are hardly any white dudes. You're gonna stick out. some of the best low pro guys are like private investigators. You know, they'll have that piece of shit car, they'll wear piece of shit clothes, they will act like they're drunk, things like that. Then they'll go into a neighborhood and sit there and, you know, watch somebody. Those are really good people to do that. So when you are doing a low profile operations, again, what is your job? Are you a cop that you're more than likely not gonna get into a firefight? Are you a CIA spook who's really, really top notch at this? And even if you do get into a firefight, you're prepared for it? Or are you a contractor that may get into a firefight, but you have all your gear and your go bag right beside you or anything like that? All those things are things you need to consider. In your location, what are those people wearing? Are they dressed like a lumberjack? Are they not dressed like a lumberjack? Are you in the Middle East where dudes are wearing man dresses? All that stuff. If I wore this in the Middle East, cruising around, I'm pretty sure they could spot me. They're like, oh, look, that fucking American, right? If I was in the south side of Chicago, near Cabrini Green, I don't think it's there anymore, but if it was still there, and I was wearing this, again, they're probably, oh, look at that fucking cop, right? So you have to kind of mix and match where you're at with what you have, what vehicle you're driving, even the weapons that you're carrying, things like that. So there's a lot more that goes into it than just, I'm not wearing a big plate carrier. When we would do our briefings, we would all get together. Hey, this is what we're going to wear. If we would wear a man dress that we can, you know, easily take off or easily put something over if we need to get out. Do we need to wear a head covering? All that stuff. So let's get into it. Okay, so one of the things you definitely need to consider besides blending in real well is, do you need body armor? Do you need something? This is just a law enforcement vest. I don't like these personally. I think they kind of suck. The cut is horrible. You know, when you go out to present, you get this shit going on. I don't like these, but if you're in a situation where you need something, but you can't wear your, you know, your plates, then this is all you got, right? The good thing about this is you can wear it underneath a shirt. You can wear it like over a t-shirt, but underneath an outer vest or outer jacket or whatever, and it blends in fairly well. So I can put my lumberjack shirt on and, you know, this blends in pretty good. If you're in a car cruising, somebody just glances at you, not really looking for a cop, they're probably not gonna notice that at all, right? Another really good thing about this is if something does happen, right? You can get yourself something like this, which is just a, we'll call it a mini rack, right? Holds a few magazines. This one has, you can get them with magnets on the back. Have magnets on your vest, and essentially just whoop, put it on there, right? Like I said, this one's Velcro, so I can have this in my vehicle, by my feet, in the seat, whatever, right? So if something does happen, I can open this up, pop this on, and I'm ready to go, okay? The other really good thing about this is there's Velcro all over this for identification. So if something happens, let's say you're a cop, something happens, you get on the radio, you call for help. Help start to show up. All they're seeing is a dude in a lumberjack shirt with some mags having a rifle or a pistol, what have you, firing at these guys, right? So who's the good guy? Nobody fucking knows, so they're probably gonna kill you. Not good. You can take this off, boom, okay? And then you can have some identification. You can have police, you can have deputy, you can have cop, whatever. If other cops roll up to the scene and you have something that says police on it, they're probably gonna think you're a cop, right? And then you, or if you have like, let's say a little Velcro badge, you know, whatever. In the military or contracting, if you start slapping American flags everywhere, they're gonna know you're the good guy because bad guys don't wear American flags, okay? Something like that is very simple to do, very easy. And like I said, you can slap it right on the back and they'll be able to identify you if they're coming from your rear. You can have identify features up here, right here. I mean, everything is fucking Velcro on nowadays, right? So identifying yourself is a very good idea, especially for a situation if you're, let's just say there's an active shooter or an active killer, whatever you want to call it, and you are, fuck, let's say you're waiting in line to pick up your kid at school. All of a sudden, gunfire rings off, and you're like, holy shit, you have this stuff in your trunk, you throw it on, let's say you are a cop, because if you're not a cop and you throw this shit on, you're probably going to go to jail. So you throw this shit on, you go in there, you make sure you handle business. If you don't have any identifying anything on, you're probably going to get shot, right? Not a good idea. So, some other things to consider when wearing this. You definitely still need a radio, okay? This is probably not gonna be on your Velcro thing. It's probably gonna be on your person, on your belt, whatever, right? You're more than likely, your primary is gonna be a pistol, especially if you're going low pro, because that's what you're gonna have on you, right? You're not gonna have a long gun shoved in your pants. Battle belt, war belt, whatever you wanna call this. You may or may not have this on. More than likely not. if you're cruising around in a low-profile vehicle, which is probably going to be like a car, or, I mean, if you have a shitty van and you're in the back seat, maybe, but like the driver, dude, he's not going to have this on all day, right? Again, this, just for emergencies, Velcro or magnets. The magnets are pretty cool. You can, if you wear a shirt over this, you can still do that and it'll be right over your shirt. Those are pretty neat. But like I said, your primary is probably still going to be your pistol. So you need to be very proficient at this, and you need to be very proficient at where you carry it when you're in the vehicle, okay? I know that back in the day, everybody had little things like right here, like little those circle holsters on their body armor, because in a vehicle, it fucking sucked trying to get your shit, especially like in a Humvee. So this was much easier, right? In a low pro operation, this is not what you want, because people can see that shit. So all these things are things to consider. We're gonna go out to the truck and show you a couple other things that we used to do, or little tidbits of information. Where to store your weapons, things like that, or the easiest place to store them. Velcro, you can get them with magnets on the back and Here we are in my truck, okay? My driveway, my garage, all that good stuff, okay? We're just gonna go over some of the things that we used to do, that you can still do, and kind of just a general overview, okay? Now, I'm gonna be using my son's toy guns. Why? Well, because I have neighbors, and if they see me out here with a bunch of long guns in my truck, them bastards will probably call the cops. So we don't want that to happen. All right. So you may also be asking yourself, why am I in the passenger seat? Well, because drivers drive, right? So when drivers drive, they're not going to be super overly concerned with shooting people, okay? So this is why the TC, or the truck commander, is going to be the one calling out stuff. This guy drives, this guy kind of directs traffic, right? Okay, so one, first things first, we got this, which is your common M4, right? Let's just say this is your weapon of choice. We'll pretend it's got a law folding stock on it instead of my son breaking it. And this is more likely just going to be wedged in the seat right there, okay? Easy access, you can still grab it. If I'm the passenger, I can still grab it. I can touch it with my leg constantly, so I have positive control of where it's at. Completely depending on your SOP, your unit that you're in, whether you're law enforcement, all of that stuff is going to depend on whether you have a round chambered or not. I'm not gonna get into that. All right, but you're sitting here, let's just say we have this stuff. Like, let's say we're using an iPad for navigation, okay? Which is quite possible nowadays, right? We have an iPad there. Let's say we have a radio, whatever. Let's just say we have a radio up here somewhere that's doing radio things, right? Because that's what they do. Our microphone's down here. We got a gun. Okay. So one of the things you can do, this is the inside of this vehicle is pretty dark and black. The windows are tinted. So you can take something like this, like a black smog, right? And what you can do with this is you can just kind of drape it over this, okay? It's not perfect, but after you do this a few times, you can make it to where this doesn't exactly look like part of the dash, but to it, when you're driving or when you're stopped at a stoplight, somebody may look at it and not really know the difference, okay? And that's kind of what you're going for. You're not going to be able to make this invisible, and everybody understands that, right? Another thing you can do, if possible, is get all your shit down here, right? So you don't have as much shit up here, okay? Cop cars have this the thing where you can put an iPad right here, so you can have an iPad right here and use that. Now again, the guy looking from the side may or may not be able to see this. You may have to do something to camouflage this stuff, right?
But if you've ever been to Afghanistan, these dudes have shit fucking everywhere. They got little balls to hang over here. They got, it's fucking annoying as fuck. They got shit all over their dash. So something like this on your dash is not going to be uncommon. So you can get away with that in, you know, a third world country, right? So we'll say that's for navigation and radio, okay? You know you're going to have your hand mic. A good thing to have your hand mic is down low, right? So that you can't, so somebody can't see it. You know, a lot of people like having them up here so it's easier to grab. But if it's up here and you're, you know, you can see that pretty easy. You can see the cord, all that stuff. And this is going to be a little bit more harder, a little bit harder to camouflage because it's going to be moving all the time as opposed to stuff like this, right? Got that, what you're wearing in the area that you're going to. You know, if people have more man dress than regular clothes, maybe you want to throw a man dress on, right? In your urban environment or your country environment, you know, you want to dress accordingly. Let's just say that, okay? Your primary pistol, right? Where are you going to have that? Like we discussed before, a lot of people had it on their chest when they were wearing body armor. It's not very feasible to do that. So you can, if you can carry this appendix and sit here comfortably and still be able to get to it, fine. If you're wearing a gun belt, then obviously it's going to be on your leg. If you're wearing a suit, and we'll get into this a little bit later, but if you're wearing a suit, this thing's going to be all the way back on like your 5 o'clock, right? Your go bag is probably going to be, depending on who's in the vehicle, what kind of vehicle it is. It might be in the back seat. It might be in the trunk area. If you have an SUV, obviously, you know, the trunk area in the SUV. Or it might be at your feet, completely depending, right? This thing. Usually I put this down by my feet. You can probably Velcro it down there if you have carpet. If not, throw it down there. And that way you have one leg and it can control all this stuff so it's not rattling around, right? So if we're driving and we have contact, we, you know, obviously we call it out. If we get blown up, our vehicle gets down, whatever, we can grab this. We can slap this bad boy on our chest. We can grab our rifle. If we need to chamber around, we can chamber around, right? And then we need to unass the vehicle. Why? Because these are fucking bullet sponges, that's why. Speed is security, and if you can't fucking drive, then there's no reason of staying inside the vehicle. Okay, because you can't maneuver very well from inside the vehicle. You need to get the fuck out. All right. Now let's go to the back seat. This would be for TC and driver. Drivers drive. They're gonna have all their shit stored very similarly, the same fucking way. Whatever that word is, I can't say right now. You're also gonna have possibly extra med kits. Like there's a med kit in the driver's door. There's a med kit over here. You'd have extra med kits. So let's go to the back seat and we'll show you what the window lickers look like. Okay, so I went in, I got a new gun that has a stock or a buttstock on it. It's a different one. Oh, that's cute, look at that. Watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this. All right. So, my neighbors just asked the hell I was doing. It's kind of weird to explain to them. Anyways, okay, so window lickers, right? You're going to have seats just like this. They're going to be back to back with that guy. And basically, you're looking out here. Blah, 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 right? You are going to have, if you're doing a low pro operation, everybody's going to be wearing roughly the same stuff. If it's a super low pro operation, you're going to have a car and everybody's going to be facing forward. Okay? It sucks, but that's the way it is. If you're in your Suburbans and you're doing some low pro stuff, you're going to have these kind of seats that stick out, okay? Good and bad things about these seats. The good thing is, obviously, you can see out much easier. Getting out of the vehicle is kind of awkward at first until you've done it a bunch. Same with getting in, just because you're so used to seats, you know, sitting forward. But you're more than likely, if these windows are, usually these are really dark tinted, you may or may not have your long gun like ready, at the ready, you know. It may be stored. Let's just say it's stored in the back of the seat, like a cop car. So some of those cop cars have that. Store it like this. That way, if you do see something, you can wrap, you can get it out and you can be ready to go. All right. There's a lot of things that these guys are responsible for, calling out things, seeing things that are oddities, if you will. Again, these guys have full maneuverability if they need to shoot out the back, as long as there's not a trunk monkey. Shoot out the back here, shoot out here. If these windows are bulletproof, well, then you can't shoot at them, obviously, right? So you need to do what they call cracking the door. So if I was right here, there was a bad guy. I know it's a bad guy. Let's say he's coming up on our driver's side. I can say something like cracking right. I open the door, and if they are bulletproof, what you're gonna have is you're gonna have a like a limiter strap where the door only opens about right there. Okay, these doors won't open all the way because they're so heavy, right? So you're gonna have a strap holding them. But what you can do from here is we can lean out. Right, we can say cracking right, open the door, we lean out, we use this door for stability on our back and our shoulder, right? And you can kind of wedge yourself in here. You might have to change shoulders for this depending on what side of the vehicle you're on and if you're riding left-handed, right? So you're cracking right, you're leaning out, and bam bam bam, you are taking care of whatever business you need to take care of. When you're doing this, you'll either be tethered, you can clip in, or your battle buddy over here can hold on to you, whatever. We just don't want you falling out of the vehicle, right? When you're done doing it, close the door, boom, right? And that's just one of the things that we're taught to do. There's a whole bunch more, but it's just one of those things. If this is all bulletproof, this is like an up-armored Suburban, you kind of have to do something like that, right? If you do have a trunk monkey, they can handle things a lot easier. The TC is more likely not going to be doing anything because he's concerned about a whole bunch of other shit. The driver drives. That's his fucking job. These two guys back here, the window lickers, they are the, they're the workers. They're the worker bees. They're going to be doing everything, right? If these guys need something, they got it, right? So back here, I got a, if you ever watched the video, the medical video or the video on my truck, we have a big med kit back here. Very similar to what we did in Afghanistan. We would have staged med kits, obviously, so that if we were doing something, let's say I was cracking right, I took care of business, came back, let's say they shot back at me and I got shot, right? I can come in here, my battle buddy back here, rip open this med pack, take care of me, and then we can keep on trucking, okay? If you are in a super low pro operation and your guns are stored and hidden and all you have is your primary pea shooter, right? And you're sitting back here. These vehicles may or may not be up armored. Some of the, like the Mercedes that we would have over there, some of them were up armored, but then we'd have like a Toyota 4Runner that was not up armored. So, just kind of depends. Just completely depends, right? If they're not up armored, some of them will have just like armored glass or maybe like an armor plate. Cop cars nowadays, they're putting a plate right here, like a ceramic plate on the inside, to protect the cops that are driving or in the cars, which is fucking awesome. You're probably not gonna crack your doors if this is what you're using, okay? If you're gonna try to crack your doors and then use a pistol, you're in for a fucking bad day, right? So more than likely, you're not going to use this. We did not have frag grenades, so we didn't use them. We didn't have them. That would have been a very poor choice to use if you're in a convoy like this dealing with something like that. Too much collateral damage, too many opportunities or areas for you to hurt an innocent bystander. Bad juju, right? So everything that happens here, obviously, can happen on the opposite side. These guys are calling shit out. Like I said, in Sicario, that vehicle, you call that out, let the TC know what's going on. Everybody's got radios. Everybody can hear everybody talk. So you're calling out, hey, you know, we got one car right side, you know, blah, 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 right? That way everybody knows what's going on, because maybe we're the lead vehicle, right? Maybe we are the lead vehicle and this is the navigator. and I'm just seeing that guy, or I just saw something, I need to call it out so the other vehicles in the convoy know what's going on, especially the limo, because that's where our principal's at. And as we discussed before, our primary, our whole job is protecting the principal, no matter what. So no matter what happens, that guy's got to get back home to his family, right? So, we talked about hardpointing in the other video. So if you do need to hardpoint, you're in a vehicle, it gets blown up, whatever, grab all the shit you need to grab, including like maybe an extra med kit, your fucking go bag, your long gun, all that stuff. Grab all that stuff, unass the vehicle. There is, or there are certain ways that we go about unassing the vehicle. There are certain things that we do to the vehicle when we unass the vehicle. And there's certain ways that we hardpoint into a building. And I'm not going to go over any of those because that's all TTPs and I'm not doing it. As far as in the vehicle goes, you're going to have extra water. You're going to have some, you know, what we call pogey bait, some snacks. You're going to have all that stuff at your disposal. You know, we always have a case or two of water in there. We always have some sort of something. If, you know, you didn't bring snacks, your buddy brought them. Because some rides, like, you could be cruising around for an hour or two. Or, worst case scenario, you get stuck in traffic. That's horrible, right? Why we say speed is security is because one of the things is, like, when you do get stuck in traffic, that's just more opportunity for other people to look and see who you are, which is not good. What to do if somebody does spot you, all right? Depending on who spotted you, what your mission is, who your principal is, I mean, there's a laundry list of stuff. 9 times out of 10, you're going to hit the skinny pedal on the right and you're going to get the fuck out of there. There's not really much of a time where you do a Sicario type ambush where you all unass the vehicles and just go murder a bunch of people. That doesn't really happen, but you never know. If it comes to the point where we have to unass our vehicles, it's a bad fucking day and we're calling for help. And that's when that cat team or that hate team is going to come out and they're going to help us, right? They're going to provide security for us. They're going to give us a ride home. They're going to do all kinds of stuff that we can't do because our vehicles are down or we got blowed up or whatever it is, okay?
Okay, I just went through a coat on real quick just to kind of show you another version of the low pro operations. If you ever watch like a presidential motorcade or watch a presidential speech or anything like that, you're going to see 100 dudes walk around in suits, right? But what you never see is you never see these dudes with guns. You hardly ever see them with guns at all. And when you're looking at their, how they're walking and everything, you don't hardly ever see any guns on them. Okay. There's a very good reason for that. They have done studies, and if people are watching and guys are walking around with guns, they're going to be less prone to think that they are a normal person, quote unquote, and they're unlikable. Because the majority of time you see that stuff would be like with people like Hitler and Stalin and, you know, the thousand other assholes like that that murdered a whole shitload of people. So they don't do that, right? But what you do see is you do see a bunch of dudes in suits, dark sunglasses, earpieces, and they have a shitload of guns on them. My favorite was Trump. I believe it was Trump. That you saw a guy walk around and his one hand was like this, and then like 1,000 people zoomed in on it and it looked like a fake hand because they thought, you know, he was carrying like a submachine gun in his jacket or whatever. Stuff like that is funny because it's all true. I mean, those dudes carry all that stuff. But in my world and the world that I used to be in, when you would wear a suit, normally that suit would be made or tailored wherever you were working, i.e. like if in Afghanistan, they had people making suits for people. And they would even go as far as to put like a stretchy material like under the arms and in the crotch area so that you would have more mobility. One thing that was kind of taught to us and it's gone through the years is when you do wear something like this, you don't want anything in the front. Because if your coat opens like this, you're gonna be able to see it. Especially if you get your shirt tucked in all nice, then somebody's gonna see it, and that's not good, right? So what happened? Well, everybody evolved. Everybody evolved, put everything on the back, right? You make your coat a little bit wider, a little bit longer, and you can put like your radio back there. You can put your gun back there, right? And all you have to do to overcome all this is just train. The more you train, the better you're going to be at anything, right? So, you know, you would be at the range or wherever, you know, dry firing, and all you do is, you know, train to pull your gun out. Because you have the guys in the suits, but what you don't see is the guys in the vehicles that are there just in case shit goes awry. They're going to come out with the long guns. And the guys with the suits that you can't see the guns, you know, their main job is to protect the principal. The guys with the long guns are going to come out and they're going to handle everything else, right? So, just a quick tidbit of low pro operations in a suit. Obviously, you want to look nice. You want to be presentable. Because if you're there with the Secretary of State and they are doing something overseas, you don't want to look like a turd in front of everybody else, right? You don't want to be that guy. So you want to look presentable, you want to look nice, and you want to keep all these guys hidden. That way you don't embarrass your client or your principal. Another thing to think about that one of my buddies who works for a certain three-letter agency taught me was, let's say I'm wearing this, right, and the wind blows or something, it does that number. If you have a gun appendix, or you have it, you know, right here, or if it's outside the waistband, they very likely could see that. Somebody could, and then your cover is blown, right? So what they do, which I thought was an awesome idea, was they put everything on the back, right? On the back side of the belt, you got your radio, you got your pistol, your mags back as far as possible where, you know, it's still easy to get them. They even do, like, instead of wearing a 30-round magazine for the AR, they wear 20-round magazines because the printing is not as bad. they'll have Glock 19s instead of Glock 17s. Like, all this stuff just kind of rolls up into the same thing. And the cool thing about being a contractor, knowing people that are in the know, is this information is widely distributed amongst the community, right? Because everybody wants the community to be better. Nobody wants anybody to fail, especially doing their job overseas, right? What I don't see as a contrast was when I was in law enforcement, those guys didn't do that. Like, the information dissemination wasn't there because you still had cops from the 80s thinking that the tactics Jay used were right. And then you had cops from the 90s thinking they knew everything. And then you had cops that have never done anything trying to teach you how to do stuff that they've never done. In the civilian world, you have a lot of civilians that don't know any better. And because they don't know any better, they see a guy on Instagram that has 50, 60, 100, 200,000 followers, and they think, well, they must be doing it right because they have so many followers. Not knowing that that person they're following doesn't know what the fuck they're talking about either. The person they're following has never done the job. That person they're following is regurgitating information they heard from somebody else. Not knowing the context of it, never using it downrange, nothing like that. And therefore, we get a lot of people that, you know, unfortunately still do a lot of things that are detrimental. I live in an open carry state. Every day I go to the store and I see people that they just don't know any better that are carrying open carry in a Uncle Mike's soft holster, and they have like a 1911 in there. And I'm like, dude, what the fuck? Or they'll have their Springfield XD in that shitty ass holster that comes with it when you buy it. You know, it's like, and they don't know any better, and it's not their fault because they just need somebody to teach them. But you can't go up to somebody with a gun and be like, hey, motherfucker, you're doing it wrong. Because it's just like telling somebody how to work out, telling somebody how to barbecue on their own barbecue. They're just going to get pissed, right? So you need to vet your instructors. You need to vet the people that are giving you information. How do you vet them? Ask them questions. Ask them who they know. Ask them if they can be verified by anybody. Because that type of shit goes on more often than not. And I'm not going to call a bunch of people out, even though I could. But let's just say there's a lot of people on Instagram that have lied a lot and have told people a lot of information that is complete bullshit. And the reason why it's complete bullshit is because they've never done it and they don't know that it doesn't work. So just remember that shit.